Desmos Live, let's go. Great to see you folks here. This is the last episode of the calendar year. This is the week where we are going to put 2020 in a box. We're going to tie a bow around that box. We're going to put that box into another box made out of concrete and then throw that whole thing off a bridge into a very deep river and say so long. The worst of this year is really evident to all of us. I mean, this is a year that people will study in history books. How's that feel to be living through history? You know, 97, I was alive then. No one studies 97, no one cares, you know, but 2020, kids, years, decades, centuries from now, we'll study 2020. It's a pretty big deal. So it's bad, and we chose to focus today on, for our last episode of the year, on what's good and amazing about you folks, this community, all of us. To start with, to end with, we'll have a review of just some of the most amazing stuff that we saw you folks do in our community this last year. The best activities you folks created, art you created, ways you interacted with students that blew our minds. Before that happens though, I wanted to bring on some folks who are, we are very friendly with these folks. I am personally just in awe of their creativity and how their minds work. We're bringing on Public Math. Would you folks toss a thumbs up in the chat to our friends at Public Math? I'm surprised that they showed up without wearing some kind of like elaborate mask or identity obscuring kind of thing. Like, they live in my mind as kind of celebrities, like the Gorillas or these kinds of artistic folks who, like, you aren't sure like if they're real or a collection of artists or one person or whatever. I've just been in awe of what Public Math does. All of which is to lead up to the question for you folks: what is Public Math? Christopher.
Yeah, so I'm...
Or Molly.
introduction. I'm Molly.
Let's go around the horn here and tell them who you are, first of all, and then what is Public Math? What do you folks do?
I really wanted to say I'm Molly, so that's me. I'm Molly.
I'm Christopher. By day at Desmos, by night at Public Math. And just before Chris introduces himself, I just want to say that, Dan, I thought you were about to say that at least one of these people is the Banksy of Public Math, and that is that guy right up there. And it would not be the first time that the comparison has been made.
Oh, no. Who, me? Chris says. Who, me? No, please, no. Keep going.
Top right. Hi, everyone. My name is Chris Noh. I am, by day, math teacher at High Tech High here in San Diego. And by night, I put on a mask and work at public, chip away at Public Math Project.
Right on. Yeah. So what is Public Math? Let us know, Christopher.
It's we started out as just a collective, informal collective of, as you pointed out, creative and interested people in trying to get people to rethink how we view mathematics. We're now an actual nonprofit founded in the state of Minnesota, soon to be federally recognized for tax evasion, tax deduction purposes. And we depend on volunteers. We have still have a great collective of folks that interact with us in lots of ways, both in the physical world, supporting projects, and a really fun community on Slack. Get in touch if anybody's interested in getting connected with volunteering with Public Math. But most of the world thinks about, when they think about math, they think about school math. And to the extent that we think about math outside of school, it's often school math outside of school. Like, you go to CVS and you're looking at the magazine rack and there's a few workbooks there. There are some novels for sale, right? So reading takes place outside of a school context, but anything having to do with math is sort of worksheets and relating back to school math. Our goal is to broaden what people think math is, who people think participates in mathematics, and where that mathematics takes place. And for us, the essential piece is that any project that we're interested in working on is going to be interactive. So Chris will talk to you a little bit more about this in a moment, but one way that we think about interacting is by giving you tools, putting tools into people's hands, or putting them in their way and in public spaces that help you that enhance the mathematics that already exists in your world. So we have a postcard you can cut some angles out of and then try to frame those angles in the world, right? We didn't create the angles that you're seeing through your postcard. We gave you a tool that helped you to see that those angles already exist. And the other way is through layering, thinking about where are places that math doesn't yet exist, or forms of math that doesn't exist in that place, but where it would feel natural. And so one of our favorite projects is the math vending machine, little 2-inch capsule in a vending machine in a gift shop. And these old tiling turtles didn't already exist there. We put that math in the way, but in a way that seems natural in the place that you are attending. Thinking about the those two ideas about enhancing and layering, and about using things that already exist in the world, whether it's gift shops or the mathematics of angles, Chris and Molly and I invented a little game over the last week. Want to talk about that, Chris? Launch it?
Yeah, absolutely. So the slight bit of framing maybe to add here is we've obviously been in pandemic quarantine mode with you all. And so what is public anymore? You know, it's really the library and the math museum and places we were parks are sort of not the places where we're gathering anymore. But just because we're physically distant is not a new idea. Doesn't mean we're socially distant. And so where are we connecting? And I think one place we've been having a lot of fun is on social media. And so today we're going to launch a little game here. And, you know, the best way to learn what is public math is probably to have a hands-on experience with it. And so I'll read that text out because just in case it's a little small. It says, hey, Twitter, play a game with us. It's called This Equals That. And we want to give credit where credit is due. This book is it's inspired by a book by photographers Jason Fulford and Tamara Shostin. A link to buy that book right there. And it's a game about making connections. And so here's what I'm going to do, Dan. I am going to tweet something in just a second. And I'm going to tweet two emojis. And the way I want you to think about these emojis are that they are the, you open up this book and you see one of these emojis on the left page and one of these emojis on the right page. Okay, I just sent that off. So would you mind refreshing your page so that everyone can also see that? And folks, this will all be on our Public Math Twitter page, so you can see it there. Ah, interesting. This equals that. So there's a little red push pin icon and then a red balloon icon. Here's what we'd like for you to do here, Dan. Would you mind hitting that quote tweet button?
Oh, right on, right on. I see where this is going. Hang on. Yeah, let me grab that here. Okay, quote tweet. Let me zoom out just a little bit right here. Okay. So block? No, what is it? What do I want to do here?
No.
Wrong one. All right. Quote tweet. Here we go. Yeah.
And actually, Jess tweet. Oh, wow. Desmos will play a lot.
From the Des account here, folks. That,
click emoji and find that balloon that we used there. That last, that second emoji we just used. Okay, so what Dan is doing right now, folks. Oh, wait. Dan is turning the page. Oh, beautiful, Ben. Thank you. Dan is turning the page of this book for us, and on the left side of Dan's page is a balloon. And here's what we want you to do now, Dan. Look through the emojis, or if there's one that pops into your mind, find an emoji that you feel like is connected to this one. Find an emoji that you feel like is connected to this
one. Yeah, I got one. There's got to be ice cream in here somewhere. Hang on. Yes.
Ooh.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Go ahead and smash that tweet button.
Is that the game? Is that it? Oh, I love this game. This is so fun. That's beautiful. All right. Let's see where this goes. Hop onto the Desmos Twitter feed where I've just tweeted probably our least comprehensible tweet to anyone who's not on this call. I love it. We'll see what repercussions come from that and make it happen. I want to say a couple things and then kick it to Molly to find out what your favorite project has been of this last year, Molly. These folks have their 2020 year in review at their website. It'll be in the show notes later. And I just want to say, like, everything Christopher was saying beforehand as the lead up here, I was tracking, but I know that kind of language is common to a lot of math-oriented nonprofits. Like, there's a lot of happy talk about, like, students feeling, you know, empowered, actualized, math being humanized, that kind of thing. And the difference is, to me, the stuff that Christopher held up in his hands, like how these ideas don't just manifest themselves in like white papers or that kind of a conference talks or advocacy of that nature. Like, they actually like make physical stuff that engages the mathematical mind. And that to me is just wild, wildly cool. So I want to just invite Molly to share. Molly, what's been your favorite your favorite project from Public Math. I actually asked you this, and you brought this one right here. What are we looking at right here? What is this?
Yeah, so my favorite project, I have to say, one of them, is the iOS stickers that we created. And if you go to public-math.org, if you have an iPhone, I strongly recommend you go there to find out how to access these stickers and use them for your own photos. But as a math photo enthusiast myself, I pretty much ruin every family vacation at this point by slowing down to take math photos. I'm confident at some point I'll be injured trying to capture the perfect math photo somewhere. But I was already walking around asking myself, you know, how many, which one doesn't belong in my environment. I was already trying to find and photograph shapes and quantities in the wild. But the stickers really serve to enhance that thing that I was already doing and allow me to kind of capture, apply those to my own photos, and then capture my own curiosity and share that with someone else. And for me, the social exchange of math curiosity is really, especially in a playful way, is really kind of central to Public Math goals and the media that we try to design. So that's definitely one of my favorite and most useful projects I think we've done.
Yeah, this is the first I saw. I did not see like names attached to this right here. And I was like, who is this? What is this? It really blew my mind. This merging of popular technological forms, the world out there, this sense of non-evaluativeness. Like, I'm not right or wrong on these things. It was just awesome. Folks, here's the deal. In the comments, I need you folks right now. We're going to do a little improv game. I'm just so curious how these people, the Public Math mind works on these ideas of layering math and putting math in the way. And so they've taken, you know, iOS stickers, they've taken Cheez-Its, they've taken emojis, and they've turned these into mathematical investigations, a medium for mathematics. So we're gonna do some improv. I wanna test them out here. I'm inviting you folks right now to drop into the comments on YouTube an object, a possible delivery medium for mathematics. We're gonna give these folks a couple minutes to talk it over and let us peek into how they turn random everyday objects into mathematics. So hit it in the comments. We got a lot of folks here in the comments right now saying, hey, what's up? We got all of the Desmos Discord server folks. If you folks don't know who what a Discord server is, ask a youth. And they're here now and they are in it. I'm very excited to see what kind of vehicles they'll come up with here. We got Kent saying, loving the Public Math photo stickers. We got the, thank you, whoever pinged the Discord server that Desmos Live was on, thank you. We love your energy, you folks. We got some fun people here. Some of my favorite long timers. All right, here we go. We got one person, Adam Baum says he did the tweet thing. So looking for some objects from folks in the chat. David, heard me say math's being humanized and had a question there. That language around rehumanization comes from Rochelle Gutierrez. And I was looking at the stickers that Molly brought up, and I see that as Rochelle Gutierrez's discussion of math as a visual medium. Like, it's so visual what you folks did there. It engages the senses. Okay, we got a bunch of folks bringing some stuff in here. A cat as a medium, telephone pole. Carl Oliver on the stream. Welcome, Carl. Great to see you. Looking for a few more objects to choose from. Telephone pole, cat. Are the stickers available on an iPad? Question to you folks.
Yeah, anything iOS. Yeah. And we'd actually love to get them in Android if anyone, we just didn't have quite the knowledge base to make that happen. So.
If you folks
can know, I just rule out cat? We don't mathematize living beings.
All right, we're doing telephone pole, folks. Kendra Lockman is inviting you folks to think about how a telephone pole could be turned into a vehicle for mathematics. Over to you.
So,
give a little bit of thought. Give it like 10 seconds of thought.
I'm ready to go.
You're ready to go. Christopher's on. Yeah, let's rock and roll here, and then we'll say so long. Over to you, folks.
So, Chris, as a Chicago... So a lot of our work comes out of narratives too, like thinking about place, thinking about how we live our lives, how we interact with the places. And so Chris is in San Diego now, but formerly a Chicago resident. And you're walking down the street, Chris, and you see a telephone pole. Is there anything on that telephone pole?
Oh, yes. Wanted. Or no, not wanted. I don't live in the Wild West. Missing, missing sign. I was thinking with wanted is the ripoff too, you know, call this number if you need this.
Yeah, so there's paper, right, attached to those telephone mm-hmm. poles. We're announcing things. We're looking for lost cats. There's your cat, Dan. There's little things that you can rip off. Concerts are being introduced, and so we've got a lot of possibilities there. I mean, I just want you to be able to take a shape, right? So those little things. You know, it's not a phone number, just a shape. Take a hexagon.
Yeah.
Molly, what's your read?
Take it. Yeah, same thing. You can take it and now look for it somewhere else. Where else might you find, or can you find me? But I also think about, I think Christopher's going to say something else.
No, go.
Oh, we also think about like how long, you know, some poles are in some places where you might be standing for a while, and other poles you might just be walking by. So that's got to come into consideration too. But it definitely should be a friendly paradigm. Yeah, that people know how to use. So the tear-offs, I know what to do with it.
So that's one thing.
Last call, Chris. Over to you.
What Dan was saying about like, it's nice that they're actually making posts. I think we care a lot about prototyping and prototyping quickly. So if things like, do we put shapes in here? Do they look like our postcards and they say missing? Or do we use the word find this, right? Help, we lost it. Can you help us find it? Take a shape, we get some perforation going on here, and then hexagons or this and that, and you can have your own collection, different telephone poles or different sided polygons, you know, make your own set of pattern blocks by walking around the neighborhood, that kind of thing.
That's beautiful. I feel like you've done both options here.
Square missing. So fabulous.
You've done the layering of math on the world, as far as I understand your work here, with like tearing this off and looking for it somewhere, and also putting math in the way, your other kind of idea where like we're not used to seeing math on telephone poles, so you're getting it right there. I also feel like you might be doing a disservice to every missing cat and dog in the world by kind of making people distrust. I mean, people see one of those signs and it's like, I should tune in because I've seen this cat. And now people are going to be a little bit less likely to tune in to people's missing pets through your efforts, but hopefully we'll enjoy math more. Folks in the chat, give it up for Public Math. Give them some encouragement about their work. Check out public-math.org for more, their annual report. Find that emoji, that emoji game on the Desmos Twitter feed. Let's get that. Do not break the chain. I mean, start the chain for sure, and do not break it once it's going, or bad luck will befall you, and you don't need that in 2020 as we wrap up. Folks, thanks for being here. Really appreciate your time.
Thanks for having
All right, me. Team. Yeah, it was a blast. Love that team. So here's the deal. I thought I was having my colleague Faith Moynihan on to take us out with the Desis, the Desi Awards. She might still show up. We'll see. But what she has done, we've taken just a zillion links from around the internet of Desmos and math-oriented stuff, and I gave her some finalists, and she chose some winners in a few different categories that are pretty fun. So I'm going to just share with you her take, my take on the best of 2020. And we'll let that send us home here. So the first category here is the international category, where we saw people doing Desmos. We got in the last year, 2 years, we've had a director of, a vice president of international growth, Johnny Lin, who with his team has just really gotten out there and helped people in other countries understand like how this tool, these activities, could be useful for them, could help their students experience mathematics. Anyway, we got folks in Russia who are talking about a word problem. I don't read Russian. I do know how to click this this button here and turn it into English. And this right here is how to use Desmos to solve a problem about two old women who are coming out to meet from two villages at dawn, and people using Desmos to solve that. And that's just awesome to us to see our tools used in that way. Down here in the comments, I do love seeing Elena here call out the pseudo context, saying one walk for 15 hours. It's unrealistic if we talk about connection with life. Though I do know a 90-year-old Belarusian old woman who rides a bus to the neighboring village. Anyway, love that. We got this Japanese graph art contest that's been running for like 16 years. Moving away from the hardware calculus that they were using over towards Desmos. We dug that. These are all finalists, not the winner though. We got an Argentinian newspaper talking about Desmos in quarantine in Argentina. ¿Quién dijo que las matemáticas son aburridas? Who thinks that the math is boring? Not Desmos, right there. Dig that a whole bunch. Really cool. The winner, according to Faith, was the Desmos, Maestros de Desmos Facebook group, which is relatively new, is popping off with so much interesting thinking about how Spanish-speaking cultures and images and those references might support students in learning learning mathematics with our tools. Doug, that if you head over there relatively soon, you can see me offer my own broken Spanish and welcome them to the group, at least until I delete that. So that right there is the international category. A few more categories. That was the winner. Nice job. Accessibility. We are so excited to support people in learning mathematics across all kinds of differences, you know, cultural, geographic, language, as you just saw, but also physical differences, like students who have vision impairments. And so you might have known that we can like play graphs audibly. It's like right here. This is a finalist right here, a finalist. Someone experiencing that. Another finalist, someone took that sinusoid and really did some fun stuff with the amplitude right there. Dig that. Okay. Also a step function, that floor function, what'll that sound like? Okay, and Faith's pick for the winner in this category. I give you this right here. Okay, that's nice. That's nice. Wait for it. Give it up. Huh? That goes on for a while right there. We're gonna put in the show notes the links to the winners here. And I got folks in the chat saying, "Hey, where's the Discord server category?" And I'll tell you, like, it's coming up here, folks. So just stay tuned. Give that one up right there. You know, like, Pro Tools costs like a couple $100. Ableton costs $600 maybe. Why use any of that multi-track fanciness when you can just use a Desmos audio tracer several times over? Multi-track mixer right there. We had an art contest earlier this year. Loads of fantastic art finalists and winners there. Since then, there's been some more amazing stuff. I want to share some art with you and share with you Faith Moynihan's pick of the year of 2020. Check it out. Here goes, folks. We got Kelsey O'Toole, who not just had students make art, but then printed that out into shrinky dinks. Huh? Like, actually made some physical stuff that, you know, shrinks underwater, I guess, as a shrinky dink. I don't know what that is. Someone tell me in the chat what a shrinky dink is. Anyway, look at that beautiful stuff right there. That's amazing. Strong work. We had an art contest over in the UK with our colleagues Tom Button and I believe Natalie Vernon's name. Some fantastic folks at MEI Math. And look at these right here. That's beautiful. Isn't that gorgeous? And this right here. Woo. All finalists here. Didn't take it for Faith, but real nice. This butterfly, also a finalist, strong work. The winner here, I really want to know why Faith chose this one. I love it. I'm just curious what Faith's extremely thoughtful about lots of things. I'm curious what her take was here. But this is some art created by an Indigenous student at a school in British Columbia. And check it out. We got here original art by Kiki. I'm going to go with Desjarlais, maybe. And she's a member of the Plains Cree First Nation tribe in Saskatchewan. And check it out, like, made that fish, that art, Indigenous art in Desmos, and then it got wild. More fish. Check all that out. Those individually printed, cut, colored fish. Gorgeous art. A winner. Couple more categories here, folks. We just, it's been a trash year. It's been a trash year, but it was just such a palate cleanser for this year for me and Faith, I assume, to go back through all of it and just dig it and see what you folks have been up to. Des Animations, a couple weeks back, Suzanne Vonoy shared some techniques that are central to our graph team's work at Desmos. By the way, which is currently hiring. So if this animation work excites you, check out our jobs page, Google Desmos jobs, or check the show notes and have a look at this. Anyway, we got people like Caitlin Bookbinder just doing some neat stuff with animations to illustrate some concepts, like how do you know when angles across from a side? Or you got Patty Stevens, a finalist here as well, showing how you can transform, rotate around the origin with an animation. Dig that so much. You got Trey Ghosh, who's doing some Pac-Man work, inspired, he said, by Patty Stevens. Also love it. Finally, the winner here. Let's go, baby. Give it up. Some thumbs up in the chat. Show some love. This right here, we got Lauren Batel. Her students, these are all her students. She spun up right after the animation workshop from Suzanne. She spun up a contest or art gallery with students who are, look what they're doing here. Like some neat scaling, some position work, all nicely timed. This is about a minute long. There's some just fantastic ones in here with just some real genuine art and a sense of humor that just makes me miss being interacting with students on a regular basis, checking out volleyball. Kids are wild for the scaling. Wild for the scaling. What do you love here, folks? Give it up. Got some more. Got some lemonade. Dig that. Turns into batter. Fades out. Turns into pans. Moves over into the oven. What's it going to turn into? Cakes? What? What happens next? Gets frosted? Are you kidding me? There's the fly. Uh-huh. Okay. Kids getting political. Dig it. Okay. Making another political contribution here about mushrooms. Anyway, I dug all that. It's just so good. It's just so good. So that was the winner there in the animation category. Couple other categories here. Dez Music. There was only one entrant into this category, which wins by default. And that was this music video submitted by some students and their teacher in North Carolina about 9 months ago. It's Desi How You Graphing. The tune is of Good As Hell by Lizzo. And we're not gonna watch the whole thing. You can find it in the show notes. It's a blast.
This is my domain.
I asked Faith to let us know what her favorite bar was of that entire music video, and she came up with this one right here. This is her favorite. Check it out. This rhyme.
Ooh, girl, now let's go for a ride. Gotta take a deep breath. Time for marble slide.
Nice. Yep. Dropping bars. Yep. Nothing but facts. Good stuff there. Couple more here, folks. Culture and community. I put the call out in the Desmo Slack channel, in all hands, we call it. Asking folks there, what was your favorite this year? What was a highlight for you? And one of my colleagues, Shira, who you've met before on Desmos Live, just said, in general, teachers focusing on the social emotional needs of students in this particular time was just so heartening to see that there was attention to mathematics and math learning, and there was also attention to students' emotional needs, and also the realization that those two are very tightly connected. Like, do not try to separate those. We made our own contributions here. Like, here is a robot we coded up that to help students express how they're feeling on a given day. Because you can copy and paste our slides, this right here, this robot made its way into, I just found this out today, 60,000 activities this last year. That robot got around. Love that. And what you folks did was also fantastic. Some finalists here in this category, we saw hand turkeys, lots of hand turkeys, dig it. We saw pumpkins, also dig it. And then we saw haunted houses, gonna turn those into gingerbread houses. Nice job, Ms. Kaiser. Winter sweaters from Joel here, love it also. Larissa Peru really kicked off some fantastic snowflake work, and like also like had students create snowflakes and then embedded them into a kind of an omnibus jumbo activity that had all of them in it. Love that so much, and I'm sure the students did as well. Those were all great, and I'll just be real that like what we love to do is see those ideas, like the pumpkin carving idea or the snowflake idea, and then just come alongside and offer some of our expertise with this platform and tools and activities and amplify those efforts, like offer a challenge creator or some little extra styling or whatever we can do to make it more fun or more delightful. But it all started, every one of our efforts starts with insights and ideas from you folks. We are just so honored to be a part of this community, a community that just really showed up in a trash year. So here's the winner, according to Faith, is this Claire Wombold. Talked about how her students are just suffering, and she was able to use Desmos to check in on students in an important way here, asking them if they knew who their counselor was, and if they did, okay, have you had contact? Great. If you don't know who your counselor is, do you need some help figuring that out? Anyway, like, we did not invent our tools for explicitly this kind of purpose. We're so happy to see it repurposed in this way. We've learned a lot from you folks. Great job, everybody. Give it up for the winners and the finalists. A couple more categories here. Hey, your coworkers found out about Desmos this year, it turns out. This was really wild to see that teachers of Arabic were using Desmos Activity Builder, that teachers of Spanish as well, that science teachers, including like a biology teacher here, Sam Long, using the ordering component in Activity Builder. We got others, like for instance, social studies using Activity Builders. The people were wild for card sorts, it turns out. Furthermore, chemistry and physical sciences. Love that card sort right there. Some cool images. Nice little multi-select box there also. The winner, according to Faith, Faith's pick right here, so don't blame me, is this right here, a Desmos activity used by a science teacher. And I wish I knew what was going on here. I was hoping that Faith could let me know, and I'm going to have to quiz her about it in a little bit. But right here, there's like this, is a piece of text, and then there's the highlighter. And I'm just curious what is the question here? Anyway, they're using the highlighter in some fantastic ways. And I love the overlay here, which helps the teacher see kind of the heat map of where students' eyes were drawn. I dig it for my own reasons. Faith had hers. We'll find out. Anyway, a couple more last ones here. In the alternate testing category, we have three categories left, I believe. There were four finalists, and there wound up being, according to Faith, four winners. She refused to choose a winner here. They were all that good. Ways that you folks changed how you assessed in this year where a lot of changes needed to be made. So Kathy here, she did this this self-assessment in a card sort. Like, which problems can you can you solve independently? Which one do you need more practice on? Nice work. Nice use of a card sort. A self-assessment. We had another winner, finalist/slash winner. Martin Joyce, look at that last word right there. Grace, just giving some grace on quizzes and tests. You know, going over an answer, resubmit their mistakes, get full credit. Love that right there. Others doing team quizzes in breakout rooms. They had fantastic discussions. Felt like a win. Maddie needed a win. So did everybody else, no doubt. And the last finalist slash winner, according to Faith, Rebecca McKee, I believe in Southern California. Unit test. We're all going slide by slide together on this quote unquote test. They could present their screens to the class. Half the class presented. That's no small thing in a time where just getting kids to turn on their webcam is a challenge oftentimes. Just loved it. Okay, two more categories here, I believe. This is the category called Wait, That's a Graph? Question mark. This one is maybe a shout out to our colleagues from the Discord server. So check it out. I'm gonna load up a few tabs right here. Here were the finalists and the winners. Yeah, here we go. Okay, so first off, we had some students, some eighth grade students that made, look at this gorgeous cityscape. Creating some curve lines. Students only knew how to do, or only taught how to do linear equations. But if you're gonna like say, hey, we're gonna take your work product here and print it out and put it above all the lockers in the school, like students are taking some pride in their work right there and wanna do some independent learning to figure out how to do curve lines. Love that right there, so cool. Check them out, look at the detail in that stuff. Beautiful work, team. Finalist, we got the desert bus. I'm still not sure this is real. This right here is, wait, that's a graph? Yes, this is a graph. I believe it came off of either Reddit or Discord. I don't know the difference and refuse to find out. Anyway, I'm actually like driving the bus like a champion. Wait, crossing the divider. All right, come on back here. What is going on? I don't even know. Awesome. Another finalist is this right here. Check it out. I'm gonna dial speed down because I am in that mode right now. And watch this right here. I'm flying the plane. I did such a good job flying driving that bus. I think I'm ready to fly a plane here basically. Anyway, I just love this so much right here. This 3D work is so, how's this even working? This is a graph? No, this is like a game. Anyway, love that, I'm terrible at that. This right here, can't believe this is a graph either. What is going on here? Okay, hang on. Oh, all right, here we go. Jump it. Oh yeah, get some air. Okay, all right, it's freaking out now. Hey, that's pretty special though, pretty wild. Finally, here's the winner of the category, is this thing right here, whatever is going on right here, check it out. This is the sort of thing that you didn't know was possible, I didn't know was possible, Discord and Reddit knew was possible. This is incredible. Like, you folks look like marble slides for its physics, you know, its physics engine or whatever. Look at this right here, change the velocity, fired off the x-axis. What can we do with this? I need the public math folks back on the call to figure out what they're gonna do with this right here. It's just, I don't even know, but it's beautiful. That's the winner of the category, Strong Work Folks. All right, your activities is gonna take us home. Here it is. I went and looked at the top three activities as used by you folks. You know, we release some activities in ourselves, but you folks built a bunch and some of them were like way more popular than ours. So here's the top three in no particular order, except the last one is Faith's favorite. Let's load those up right here and then we'll say so long. Okay, first up is this Snowflake Challenge Gallery, perhaps inspired by Larissa Peru, built by Steve Phelps, tuned up by Eli Lubroff over on our side. And what it is you can create a snowflake. Just think about all the geometric concepts here around transformation, rotation, all of this going on. You can kind of rotate this, the color space right here. Woo, woo. And then submit that into the gallery for your classmates to see. That's just bonkers, right? Just bonkers. Love that right there. And then the another finalist was right here, Lesson 0.1. Extremely popular from Julia Anker in Southern California as well. And what she did was, we had a very interesting reaction that she might not know about when we saw this. First off, we were like, this is fantastic. She like starts with, you know, some like social emotional learning type activities here, get to know you. Like this is for the first lesson of the year for students. But then she goes and she like implicitly tells us at Desmos, like here is where students might have trouble with your work. Like sign in with Google. Don't press the continue without signing in button. Okay, cool. And then there's other stuff here. Like for instance, let's practice how to type how to type mathematical things in LaTeX in this input right here. And so our reaction was, oh my gosh, this is so useful. Also, we should make our technology so much better so that teachers like Julia don't feel like they have to create this kind of thing. So we like took all of this and turned it into tickets and feature requests and put it in our system. Anyway, it's so useful. The winner of the top three here, we had Four Fours by Kenneth Clarkson. I saw this and I was like, wait, this is possible? You pick an animal avatar, and then you are into the four classic Four Fours game, where you figure out, you know, let's see here. Oh, you gotta click on what it is right here. So that's eight. And so here I submit it, and I got it. So I just made eight using Four Fours. And the idea here, it's just bonkers to me that it like aggregates the entire class. So a teacher at a certain point can say, hey, we've got all of them except for 74 or whatever it is. And then the whole class like turns their, you know, their brains like an ion cannon onto that particular number right there. I swear, I was asking the Desmos team when I first came on as a consultant way back in the day, 2013, we should do this. And we're talking about like how it would take like months and months and months. This is pre-activity builder. And then just to see someone take the tools that we had lying around and build this, you know, I'm on a scoreboard or whatever. I don't know. Like it just bonkers that this happened during just the worst year of so many of our careers or lives. Awesome stuff. So give it up for all that amazingness. I'm going to check the comments in a little bit and see what you folks were into. I just want to sign us off here. We're a little past, and I want to wish you folks a much better 2021. And I want to say we'll be joining you back in January with a new episode of Desmos Live, where we're going to share with you some of the best activities we've got under wraps, and we'll vote another one of them into existence in the public pool. But I want to say what's good for your health is also probably good for your career here. Like I hope more than anything that all of us come back together in January, that we all survive this thing, both personally, that no one catches this awful disease and dies from it, and also professionally. There are so many teachers who are feeling so demoralized, so exhausted. No cohort of teachers has ever deserved 2 weeks off more than this one has. So, you know, like the idea of traveling doesn't just sound like dangerous for your health, but also not restful. So do what's good for your health and what's good for your career, please. And just like chill out and see if you can watch a movie or a lot of movies or binge an entire show of some sort. So I'm just so grateful. We are all so grateful. On behalf of Desmos, I want to say we look back at all this and we're so grateful to be part of this community with you folks. No one's ever worked harder or more creative than you folks have, and we are so excited to be alongside, adjacent to, an amplifier of, a celebrator of all of that. So, folks, we'll catch you in the new year. Take care.